Okay, welcome back to session two. By now you probably have already emailed in your questions for session one. So again, at the end of this session, you've got your 10 questions. Just go ahead and copy and paste them onto a Word document and then email me the document in. Session two is going to be going over patient resident needs, and we're going to be talking about communication. We're going to talk about basic communication first, and then we're going to be going in and talking about communication challenges with a lot of our elderly that we deal with. Now, when we're talking about communication, we have to understand a couple of basic things. And again, if you got the textbook here or have it, basically where we're going to be in is going through chapter 3 and chapter 4, starting about page 31. Now, one thing with communication we have to understand is there's a difference between active listening and actually hearing. So listening and hearing are not the same. I tap the table here, so you heard a sound. But when you listen, you actually are actively engaged to understand the meaning behind what is being said. One time, as a little bit of a joke, one time I wanted to prove to my staff that we hear, but we really don't listen sometimes. So normally in America, when you meet somebody, at the start of the day, you greet them and, hi, how you doing, Bob? And the normal answer back is to say, fine, thank you, how are you? Well, one day I went around with a smile on my face, very upbeat tone of voice, and answered back, terrible, thank you, how are you? Nobody caught it all day long. And that, like I said, was to basically prove that a lot of times we hear, but we don't listen. So we have to be actively engaged with our residents. Now, a lot of times in communication, there can be blocks to that communication. And most of the time, what it is our nonverbal. We're rolling our eyes, we're not looking at the person that we're talking to, we're tapping our fingers or our feet, we're real antsy. All that communicates a negative, that whatever you're saying is not really that important to me. And nonverbal versus verbal communication, nonverbal so many times is much more believable than verbal. If you walked into your director of nurses' office, and let's just say you've been working there for about a year, very hard, you've been coming in on your days off, you've been working some extra overtime, staying over and stuff like that, and you've never missed a day, and you walked into their office, you have an uncle and aunt that's coming by. You haven't seen them in several years, they're only going to be in town for a few short hours, and you simply would like to see if you could get the day off. Okay, here's the two scenarios. The first scenario, you walk into their office, you present your case that you'd really like to get off, and the director of nurses is sitting at their desk, and they're writing, and as you give your presentation, they keep on writing, and they say, oh, is that so? Well, I'll see what I can do. Now, here's scenario number two. You go in, you start presenting your case, they take their pen, they put it down, they look directly at you, and they say the same words again. Oh, is that so? Well, I'll see what I can do. Well, it's obvious which one that you believe that you have a chance of getting that day off. Even though both verbal were the same, it was the nonverbal. So we have to be really aware of the verbal that we give to these residents. We tend to always, or mostly, if not always, mostly believe the negative. The example of that is, look at any grade school in America. If there's a child in there that gets called to the principal's office, as that child walks down there, two things are probably going to happen. One, their pulse rate's going to go up because they believe that they're in trouble. And the other is the rest of the students in the classroom are going to giggle because they're convinced, yeah, they are in trouble. So, and the child may be going down there to get a ribbon or a trophy from an award from a spelling bee or something like that. But we always believe the negative. Not always, I shouldn't say always, but a lot of times we believe the negative. So with our nonverbal, it can be easily perceived by our residents as a negative message. Because they can't hear well, because they can't see well, a lot of times they will feel like we're unhappy with them or we're upset with them, and they will get hurt immensely because of that. So we have to be acutely aware of the fact that basically of our nonverbal, of our body language. The generation that you're taking care of, touch means a lot. It basically means acceptance. I care for you. I appreciate you. Now, remember the chart. We're going to be talking about charting here in just a little bit. The chart's a legal document. Now, in your nursing home, you may do different variations of charting. You may do it on the computer. You may have a headset that you speak into, or you may have the paper charting. Whatever it is, remember the chart's a legal document, okay? Now, if you do paper charting, there's some special rules you've got to follow. You never use whiteout, you never erase, you never smudge or try to cover something over. You never, ever want to give the impression you're trying to hide something. You just simply draw one line through it and simply put your initials. You don't do anything more than that. Now, one of the things when it comes to communication, we have to critically think. One of the things that we follow is what's called the nursing process. Now, for some of you that took your CNA several years ago, you learned assess, plan, implement, evaluate. For the newer ones, new CNA students, learn assess, diagnose, plan, so a diagnosis goes in there. So assess, diagnose, plan, implement, evaluate. But basically how that plays out is this. Let's just say you were going to have a lot of friends over for a chili dinner, and literally you were cooking for them. You're going to look in the refrigerator. Do you have the hamburger you need? Do you have the spices, the tomato paste, the tomato sauce? Do you have everything you need? Do you have the crackers? What you've just done is you've done an assessment. Now, the next step you're going to do is basically make a plan. Well, that plan is going to be, well, I don't have enough crackers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start the meat simmering. I'm going to start the tomato paste and juice simmering real low while I send someone out to the store for crackers. Then you're going to implement it. You're simply going to do it. You're going to do what you were supposed to do. And then when it's all done, you're going to evaluate it. You're going to dip your spoon in and basically taste it. You're going to evaluate it. So what you've done is you've assessed, you've planned, you've implemented, you've evaluated. So if you were in CNA like 15 years ago or something like that, those are the four steps you learn. Now today, diagnosis is put in there. So assess, diagnose. It's not a physician diagnosis, it's a nursing diagnosis. So in our scenario here, our diagnosis would be lack of crackers. So, but that's what we do when we take care of people. We assess them, we make a plan, we implement it, and then we evaluate it to see if the plan's been successful or not. We are constantly critically thinking. We are constantly prioritizing. When you pay your bills, you prioritize. You pay one first, one second, one third. One might have to wait while you pay the other two. You're putting them in order. Well, in your caring for the residents, that is the same thing also that you do. You basically prioritize. Now, So, like I said, as far as communication goes here, we always have a sender and a receiver. And right now, I'm sending, you're receiving. Now, if you need me to call you or something like that, well, then you would be sending information back to me over the phone line, or if you email me, and then I'd be receiving it. So the communication is a process of revolving, sending and receiving, and then the other person sends and the first person receives. So it's not really like a machine, but in a certain aspect, it does have mechanics to it. And like any machine, it can break down. Well, our breakdown with communication are these barriers. These barriers that can basically impede communication and basically stop it. So like I said, we know about the verbal, we know about the nonverbal. So we've got to be aware of what we say. We have to be aware of our language to the residents. You know, there was one young nursing student that was using the language of her young generation and said to a nursing resident, "Yo, you're bad," which that is a positive statement to the younger generation, but to the generation she was taking care of, the man was devastated because he really liked this young student and he thought he'd done something to offend her. So we've got to be mindful of our verbal communication, using words not of our generation, but of their generation. And then, like I said, as far as nonverbal, we've got to be aware of our body language. Touch, welcome touch especially, is part of important nonverbal communication. Smiling, of course, is. Tone of voice is. Leaning forward to a person, you know, and leaning into them, you know, are other ways that we show positive communication through basically nonverbal. And we've got to remember our appropriate words. We use the language that they are used to. And then, of course, when we send and receive, we have to be patient and let them respond back to us. Remember where I talked in session number one, how everything slows and shrinks with the aging process. The thought processes in the brain will slow down, and they may have some difficulty with word finding. So it may take them 5, 6, 7, 8 seconds to basically find the word that they are trying to say. And if we start to show impatience, it's going to upset them. And it could be a barrier to communication. Or if we even know the word they want to say and we say it for them, well, completing somebody else's sentence is another barrier to communication. We want to wait for their response. We have to pause. Now be an active listener. A lot of times as we are listening to the elderly, by what they say, we can sometimes almost hear them cry out. We have cliches in America, and one of our big ones is, "Oh, don't worry about it, everything's going to be all right." Well, basically, if an elder shares something with you and they are really concerned and really scared about it, you know, and they open up to you and share something with you, you know, and you respond with the cliche, "Oh, it's okay, don't worry about it," you know, that just shuts off the communication. Consider what they gave you as a gift. They felt that they could trust you and they could count on you to basically help them. So be that active listener. Remember, when we communicate, we communicate the facts. You know, we don't try to embellish them, we don't try to flower them in any way, but simply is the facts is what we have to basically communicate. Now, like I said, there's a lot of barriers that can happen with communication, and a barrier is a block. And so there's a lot of things that can block. Like I said, one of the big ones is that cliches that we use a lot of times, or slang language that the resident doesn't understand. A lot of times finishing their sentences, not allowing them to basically, you know, answer. Sometimes even asking them why did you do that? Why? Well, that puts them on the defensive, and that alone could be a block for communication. A lot of times giving unwanted advice could also be a block for communication. And sometimes just simply how we ask the question. If we, because there's a question, a statement that we can ask in a way, it's called an open-ended statement or open-ended question. And what that means is it asks in such a way that the person is not going to respond to you with quickly a short yes or no, but it allows them to explain how they're feeling or what they believe. And a lot of times those open-ended questions are basically the best ones to ask. Remember, and I said in session one about the word kiss, keep it short and simple. A lot of times for your Alzheimer's, for your confused, your cognitively impaired residents, simple language, short words, a lot of times will help them a lot more than the longer words. That allows them to just understand two or three words, because it's like how a train derails sometimes. Well, if we ask them a question that has several words in it, 10, 11, 12 words in a sentence, a lot of times they will pick up the first word, second word, or third word. But as the fourth word goes on, it's like the thought process derails like a train. So if we can communicate basically, for these folks especially, with a shorter communication, they will be able to receive it a lot better. And then ask it in such a way that basically their answer, they can give their answer in a shorter variety of words. Because if we ask in something that is going to take a long sentence for them, a lot of times what will happen is they'll give the first couple words will be what they want to say, but then their thought process after the third word, they start to drop it off. Remember your culture and your communications. And, you know, there's different people from different backgrounds, different cultures, different beliefs, you know. It's important for us to know the history of our residents. Some cultures, it's polite to basically have direct eye contact. Other cultures, it's not appropriate to have direct eye contact. Some cultures, touch is very important. Some cultures, touch means other things. We have a friend that's lived in China for a really long time. And, you know, it is their culture in China to eat and sit when they eat with their elbows on the table. And it's an insult to basically have your elbows off of the table. And so other cultures basically have different things with mannerisms, and it's important for us to know them, and especially with communication. The mannerisms. Now, the admissions director of the nursing home, basically it is part of their position, their job, to find these things out about their culture, about their needs, about their individualness. So that way they tell us so we know basically how to act. And like I said, be very aware, know your residents, and know, is touch acceptable or is it unacceptable? Hugging a lot of times is what a resident wants. Hand holding, that type of touch, is basically what a resident wants. One time, what I basically saw was something that was incredibly silly, and it really made me laugh. There was a lady that was in the middle of the hallway of a nursing home that I was visiting our neighbor at, and she was in her wheelchair right in the middle of the hall. In front of me was walking a young man who was carrying like a plant, and I assumed it was probably for maybe his mother or his grandmother, something like that. This lady, as she was sitting right in her wheelchair in the middle hall, what she'd do was reach out with her hand like this. And that's all she basically did. Well, as this young man got close to her, what he did was he went up against the wall like this and kind of just inched his way around her, like he was on the edge of a cliff almost, while she was reaching out like that. And all she wanted was just basically to touch him. She just wanted human contact. And it made me start to laugh. He turned around and gave me a dirty look, but I didn't care. But it was just silly. I guess he thought if she touched him, he would get old people cooties or something like that, and probably turn old just instantly like that or something. Who knows what? But touch means a lot to these folks. It's the nonverbal communication that basically presents and gives so much to them. And when we went to one nursing home in Miami County here, there was one resident, one gentleman. He knew when we were coming for clinical. He would be right at the door every day after he kind of saw our schedule. All he wanted was a handshake. He would just wait there. He wouldn't say a word. He'd stick out his hand, and I'd give him a handshake, turn around, go back to his room. That's all he wanted. What did that handshake do? It verified to him that he was still a man, because it was a manly handshake. It gave him the sense of worth and well-being. You know, who knows what all it gave him, totally. But it gave him that basically feeling there. Now, remember, we communicate, you communicate with a lot of people around you, doctors, nurses, family, other staff members, the person that comes in and fills the pop and candy machine. Customer service is vital. Treat everybody like a customer. If you owned a restaurant, everybody that came into your restaurant, you would want them to come back time and time and time again to buy your food so you can pay your bills. You would go out of the way to meet their needs, to get to know them, to make them feel comfortable, to make them feel welcome. And basically, this is customer.